Okay, folks, here we go, the last leg of our journey, and it's all going to be about architecture. Let's just go back to that thing I was telling you in the beginning about some of the innovations that came after the fire. I mentioned the ability to roll out steel, for example. That's called the Bessemer process. That enabled us to go higher and higher with those buildings because the steel frame was a lot lighter than what they used to do, which was put brick on top of brick on top of brick until it got so heavy it fell over. So we have these steel beams, and then we have the lighter materials on the front of those buildings. That's called cladding. We went from just stone to things like terracotta, glass, steel, lighter steel, lightweight steel. And you'll see a lot of examples of this as we go down the river. Also, something that has to be taken into consideration, especially on super tall skyscrapers. A super tall skyscraper, by the way, is over 1,000 feet. We have 5 of them in Chicago. They have to deal a lot with wind shear. There's a lot of, even though we're not the windiest city in the United States, we do have strong winds coming in off of Lake Michigan, and that has to be factored into, especially the taller buildings, okay? Because I don't know if you know this, but all tall buildings do sway. They have sway built into them. The architect and the designer's jobs are for you not to feel that sway, because if you feel that sway, you're gonna start getting motion sickness, and they fail at their job. You know, the Willis Tower, for example, sways 18 inches each way. You should not feel that. The only way you should know that the Willis Tower is swaying is if you're up on the top of it and you're looking down in the bathroom at the bowl and you see the water going like this. And then you know that the building is swaying as well. So keep that in mind, wind shear. Also, contextualism. Contextualism means that they're going to borrow from the environment. I've already mentioned color. They're going to borrow color. They're going to borrow shapes. A couple of the buildings are based on what the lake looks like in the winter. Now, the lake never really freezes entirely all the way across. But on the shore, you can bet there's big, huge boulders of ice. And those have inspired some of the architects on some of the buildings we're going to see as well. All right, keeping all that in mind, I'm going to start with the big white tower I talked about. The sun is gleaming on it right now in the middle of that cluster of buildings right there. And that tower used to be the third tallest building in Chicago. It's called the Aon Center. Of course, when it opened, it was called the Standard Oil Building, and we called it Big Stan. Well, Big Stan, when he first opened, didn't look like that. He was white, but not that white. He was actually clad in beautiful white Italian Carrara marble, and it was beautiful. On a sunny day, it would glisten in the sunlight. At night, when they lit it up, it would pop in the sky. But a couple of years after that building opened, that beautiful marble decided it didn't like Chicago winter, and it started cracking and falling off. So we had to take off all that marble. Oh, which, by the way, decimated the quarry in Italy where Michelangelo got all of his marble to create his masterpieces. We had to take it off. They crushed it and sent it to a refinery where they used it for landscaping material. And then they had to reclad the building in something. So they chose that rather plain-looking Mount Airy Carolina granite to the tune of $80 million, or $1 million per floor. And then the news for Big Stan just keeps getting worse. You know why? Last year, he lost his title as the third tallest building in town. So that one to the right of the next, the three-tier tower is the new third tallest building in town.